Right now, a Russian naval blockade in the Black Sea is preventing Ukraine's crops from being shipped to their normal destinations. There are somewhere around 20 million tons of wheat that's trapped in silos near Odessa and in ships literally filled with grain that are stuck in the Odessa port because of this Russian blockade. Russia is pilfering Ukraine's grain exports, to sell for its own profit. Now Russia is hoarding its food exports as well. So this is all deliberate. We know that. President Putin is stopping food from being shipped and aggressively using his propaganda machine to deflect or distort responsibility because it hopes it'll get the world to give in to him and end the sanctions.
The U.S. government continues to engage with Russian media outlets because we believe it is vital for the people of Russia to have access to information. Moscow's efforts to mislead the people of Russia and the world and suppress the truth about what they are doing in Ukraine continues, including by making it illegal to use the word war in connection with President Putin's full-scale invasion or war on Ukraine. There is no other word except for censorship.
It's so critical that we and you, this entire community, work with the platforms to find ways to more effectively ensure that they're not being abused and used as a means of propagating misinformation and disinformation. Of course, it's primarily on the platforms themselves to take the steps necessary to push back against that. I hope very much that we can continue to do that in a collaborative fashion.
We had, some of you know, a summit for democracy that President Biden convened last year. One of the main areas of focus of the summit was finding ways collectively to provide support to independent media. In my own judgment, it's hard to think of a smarter investment in our democracies, given the incredibly brave and innovative work that journalists are doing throughout our region.
To realize a more prosperous future for our hemisphere, partnerships between those assembled here are essential. It is in this spirit that I have focused on bringing companies and organizations together to collaborate and coordinate and share lessons learned, and to galvanize billions of dollars in new investments. The challenges facing our hemisphere in the months and years ahead are significant. The climate crisis, food insecurity, economic inequality, corruption, and gender-based violence.
The United States stands ready to work in partnership with all of you. Governments, institutions, civil societies, young leaders of tomorrow. And I invite my fellow heads of state and heads of government of the Americas to join me in adopting concrete hemispheric commitments that are going to advance our efforts to build a more sustainable, resilient, and equitable future. There is no reason why the Western Hemisphere can't be the most forward-looking, most democratic, most prosperous, most peaceful, secure region in the world.
This summit isn't the beginning or the end of our efforts to make democracy deliver in the hemisphere. Rather, it's a chance to engage with partners from around the region, in government, international organizations, civil society, the private sector, young people, about where we can do more and where we can do better. Together, our countries agreed to ambitious commitments in public health and pandemic preparedness, clean energy, climate change adaptation, digital transformation, democratic governance. These commitments give us benchmarks to hold us accountable by our fellow democracies and by the people that we serve.